Good morning, Duplin County. It is Saturday, the 2nd of May. A beautiful Saturday morning. It's a pleasure to be with you. You're listening to the Community and Small Biz Update for Duplin County. I am Lee Woodard. I am your host. We've got a great show for you today. Just let you know you're listening to WEGG 710 AM and W26 3BE 100.5 FM Rose Hill. And Ken's telling me I did that one wrong. I thought that's what I said, W263BE, 100.5 FM, Rose Hill. Anyway, that's my one mistake for today, so we won't make that again. Anyway, it's a pleasure to be here. My guest today is Anthony Scholler. Anthony is the bookstore manager at James Sprunt Community College, and we're really going to talk about a couple of things. I titled this show Dancing with Elephants, and a lot of people have said, what in the world are you going to talk about? But if you think about it, if you were going to dance with elephants, you probably want to do it very carefully. And we're going to talk a little bit about why the bookstore is similar to Dancing with Elephants. And then also we want to talk a little bit about the open house that will be coming up at the end of the month at James Sprunt. So, Anthony, how are you doing today?
I'm doing good, Lee. How are you?
I'm doing great. It's a pleasure to be here. And, you know, I always get some of the little things. I miss them. One of the things I should have said is this show is being brought to you by James Sprunt Community College and also by the Small Business Center at James Sprunt. So anyway, Anthony, you are the bookstore manager at James Sprunt, right?
Yes.
And you have, what, 20 or 30 employees working under you?
No, I wish. Generally, it's myself, and then I have one, sometimes maybe two part-time employees that work up under me. Depending on the influx of business, we bring in more part-time employees.
So. Right. Yeah, and, you know, I made that joke about all the employees, but then I do know that, you know, the bookstore is set up to try and pay for itself, so I know in the bank you've got millions of dollars to help support inventory, right?
I wish.
Okay. Okay, let's see. You don't have any employees, and you don't have, you know, a lot of money, but you do have lots of space to display stuff, and, you know, all the inventory that you want, you've got. No, he's looking at. So, folks, you kind of get where I'm headed. There are challenges if you're the small bookstore at James Sprunt Community College. You know, when before we get too far into it, Anthony, are you a local boy?
Oh, I am. I'm born and raised Duplin County. I'm originally from the Pinhook area. Moved over to Chinquapin, and I stayed there until 2013, and I moved over to Lyman. I bought a house there, so I'm officially a Lymanite now. So all my life, I've lived right in the area of Duplin County.
Well, I will. I have a client at the Small Business Center that does towing. So if your car breaks down in Lyman, I know someone can get right over there.
Oh, cool.
You know, you are a James Sprunt graduate as well, aren't you?
I am. I graduated James Sprunt in 2007. I got my associate's degree in accounting.
Yep. And you didn't stop there, did you?
No. I went online and. Went through Ashford University. I got my bachelor's degree in business with Ashford.
Oh, okay.
And I graduated there in last year, October of last year.
Oh, excellent. And your associate's degree was in accounting. What was your business degree in? Your 4-year?
Bachelor's.
Bachelor's. Yes. What was it? What?
Business administration.
Business administration. Yes. Okay. Mm-hmm. Other things that you've done, too, in talking with you, started, I think, you didn't start in the bookstore when you came to James Sprunt, did you?
No. Actually, I worked at BB&T in Wallace. I worked there for probably almost a year and a half, and I left from there in 2009. And upon leaving there, I started working in the business office at James Sprunt. I started out as an accounting assistant, and then in 2011, I took over the bookstore, and I've been in the bookstore ever since.
Yeah. While we're talking about education, I know when you and I had a chance earlier in the week to sit down, there's another program that you really got a lot out of, and that was the leadership program.
Exactly.
At James Sprunt. And talk a little bit about those.
Well, the end of 2013, I started our staff and faculty leadership development program. That's actually hosted through our leadership center at James Sprunt Community College, and it's basically there to help bring our employees of the college in and help them progress in the leadership roles. Outside of that, I'd also started in our Duplin County Center for Leadership Development, which is actually a really good program. And what it does is it actually takes your citizens within the county and brings them in, and it says, okay, if you live in the county and you want to end up doing something a little bit different in your county, it teaches you how to go about doing things a little bit different, and who you would need to go through and the processes you will need to take in order to be a leader in your community or county.
Yeah, that's, you know, it's interesting, and it may not seem like that has direct connection with small business, but it really does. One of the things that I work with many of my clients is how to navigate the county system, who to talk to. They're not pleased with something. A classic example will be, I've got clients at the Small Business Center that don't like the solar farms that are going up, and I've got them that do want to have them. And who would you talk to about ordinances? Who would you talk to about lobbying if you think you should be able to put them up? All of those types of things. So it would sound to me like that leadership program would be an excellent way to sort of understand how it's put together.
Most definitely.
And how to navigate it.
Yes.
Yeah, that's excellent. Going back to what I had said earlier, you know, the bookstore has a lot of competitors. Who are you competing with in the bookstore?
Our major competitors that we have is our online competitors. If I had to guess, I would say about 20% of our sales go to our online competitors, and it's really because you know, they can offer things, they can offer more than we can, and they can offer prices significantly cheaper than we can.
Well, you know, and that's where the whole idea of dancing with elephants, you know, if you're going to compete with Amazon, you've got some major challenges, some major hurdles that are sitting in front of you. One of the things I will share with you, though, one of the workshops that we run at the Small Business Center are the 20 traits that successful small businesses share. And one of the things, interestingly enough, is successful small businesses, and the definition of successful in this case is 10 years or more operating, they are never the low price in their market. They're never the highest price in their market, but they typically fall somewhere in the middle. And the successful small business really focuses on what value it brings to its customers, and hopefully, you know, you're able to find ways where you can do some things that Amazon really can't do for your students. And I know we're going to get into some of those things, because you've got lots of great ideas that you're thinking about how to do that. But let's talk a little bit about, people may not know, because I would also say one of your other competitors is Walmart. You know,
most definitely.
Yeah, and you know, you need to stop picking competitors that sales equal $1 trillion. You know, but talk a little bit about what the bookstore carries.
So our biggest product that we have in there, and basically, you know, what evolves to the reason why we're in business is we offer textbooks for the college classes you're going to be taking on our campus at James Sprunt. So basically, any class that you will be taking with us requires a textbook. And we sell those in the bookstore, whether it be a continuing education class, basic skills, any kind of math class, history, English, biology, chemistry, any kind of class you can think about taking at James Sprunt. Generally, it requires a book, and we have it in stock. Outside of that, we have supplies, basically any kind of supply you would need for your class. So say, for instance, you were taking our business finance class. We have a financial calculator. So generally with our classes, they require specific supplies. So we try to carry those in there. Your paper, pens, pencils. We also sell computers, book bags, clothing. One of our biggest things that we sell is our clothes. And that really helps us because, you know, people can go in there and they can buy a shirt and they can buy a coat, a hat, and it's got James Sprunt on it. So, you know, once they buy that and they're out in the community, it kind of, you know, sparks interest in other people in coming out there to James Sprunt.
Absolutely. It's a branding, you know, opportunity. You know, I was going to make that joke like I did. You've got, you know, plenty of money, you got plenty of employees. I was just going to say, well, textbooks are really cheap, but, you know, I can't even make that joke, because when I was in college back in the Stone Age, books were, you know, just outrageously expensive. A chemistry book back in, 1981 was 120 bucks. And I had one semester where I was all science. My books actually cost more than my tuition.
Yeah.
So, you know, books are expensive, aren't they?
Oh, yeah, definitely.
And for what your costs are, if someone could go on Amazon and do slightly better, couldn't they?
If
they were doing it. So, you know, with that, you know, one of the goals I asked you, the bookstore is not funded by James Sprunt. It's intended to hold its own, isn't it?
Well, we're an entity of James Sprunt.
Right.
Yeah, we're institutionally owned. But, yeah, overall, we're there to be in business and make our own money and keep afloat ourselves. So.
Yeah. One of the things, too, that you mentioned, I'm jumping a little bit ahead, but you do provide a benefit with students. You buy back books, right?
Oh, yeah, most definitely.
We're going to get into that.
Yeah, we do buy back the textbooks from the students, and I'm glad you brought that up because we do have an upcoming buyback. It's going to be Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday of this coming up week. It'll be 9 to 5, and it's going to be held in our Strickland Center right outside the bookstore. And a lot of times, you know, we get a lot of phone calls, you know, about what textbooks, you know, students can bring back, or do you have to be a James Sprunt student? And no, you don't. If you have a textbook laying around your house, you want to see if you can get some money for it, bring it by. You can carry it up there to the rep, and the rep will scan it, and they'll tell you, you know, hey, we can buy this book. Here's the cash for it. And generally, you know, they'll give you the cash right there on hand.
Well, I know I can't. I was one of those who kept all my college textbooks. I never gave one of them back. I just have this unhealthy emotional attachment to books. I like them. But I know I couldn't bring my chemistry book because the periodic table is different today than it was when I was in there. So, and my physics books had a chapter on unsolvable stuff. I think last I looked, half of them had been solved. So I'm pretty sure my textbooks are out of date. But that's interesting. I did not know, and I bet most people didn't know, that you don't even have to be a James Sprunt student to return textbooks.
That's right.
And I'm guessing, I don't know this, and I didn't even ask you this, but I'm guessing you could sell more used books if you could get them.
I do, or I can. Another thing that we do, too, whenever we do offer our buyback, a lot of times I will compile a list of books that I want to buy for the store, and I can sell those used in the bookstore. And what we try to do is we try to shoot for a goal that it's at least half of what a new book costs if you're going to do used. And sometimes we, you know, if we can drop the price and make it cheaper than that, then that's what we'll do. We're all about trying to save the students money.
Yeah, and you mentioned to me when we were talking about the details, sort of the buyback, that net-net, if you buy a new book and you return it, sell it back to a bookstore, typically you're going to net out about 25% of what that book cost you. Mm-hmm. And one of the things you're trying to do is improve on that return to the student, aren't you? Mm-hmm. How are you doing that?
Some of the things we do, and going off of the cheaper priced books, we look at other alternatives that you can do for your textbook. So, you know, for example, if you can buy a hardbound book and the hardbound book costs you $300, we can go to a loose leaf alternative. And the loose leaf alternative, you might save as much as $100 by going loose leaf. And you know, anything that we can do to help the students out, then that's what we're going to do. Outside of that, other things that we try to do, you know, like with the used books, we try to buy as much as we can back from the students. We do offer rental online, so you can actually go online and rent your textbooks and return those back to the company that we go through in order to help you save money.
Well, I mean, one of the things as I'm listening here today is one of the ways you differentiate yourself from your large competitors is service, just trying to help the student.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, one of the things that I hadn't thought about is we do have a large percentage of students at James Sprunt that are on some level of financial aid.
Yes.
And mm-hmm. one of the things that I hadn't thought about, if you're getting financial aid, then your books could be, are likely, or being bought through that financial aid. But when you return them, you get the cash, right?
Exactly. It's a win-win situation.
Yeah, I hadn't thought about that, but that's pretty good. Yeah, the average cost of, let me see if it's still the same. I know science was the most expensive books when I was in college, followed by mathematics, and then the philosophy was the cheapest. Is it still is it still that way today?
Yeah.
Okay.
Kind of follow suit still.
Okay. So, you know, do you buy back books year round?
We offer it at the end of every semester, so the end of our summer semester, the end of our fall semester, the end of our spring semester, and then what we've actually tried to do is come in between. So now a lot of the classes that we offer at James Sprunt are on a half of a semester. So you have a first session semester, and then you have a second session. So it's kind of like mini semesters. So in between your first session and your second session classes, we offer a buyback then as well.
Okay. And I think you mentioned that, you know, we had talked about how it nets out to about 25% for a person selling a book they bought new. You're trying to go up about 12% higher, aren't you? Trying to give them about 37%?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay. That's certainly, you know, that is something that, again, points to a lot of good service. So, you know, books are one of your primary reasons for existence. But when I walk in the bookstore, I see a lot of other stuff. Yeah. What sells besides books?
We do offer a small line of gift items. So, you know, basically if you're a staff or a faculty and let's say you come into work one day and I forgot today was Lee's birthday, so I'm going to run over there to the bookstore and I want to pick him up something nice.
That's July 12th, by the way, folks.
You know, again, like I said, if I had to say, you know, on a range of what sold the most and then what sold, you know, next to the most, I would say the first thing is the textbooks.
Right.
And then the second thing is our apparel.
Okay.
We try and make sure we push our apparel. We want everybody to wear a James Sprunt shirt or, a hat or a scarf or gloves or whatever, you know, you can think about wearing. We want you to have it and have James Sprunt on it.
Yeah. Well, actually, I got my two golf shirts with James Sprunt logo 2 days before I even started. So, because I knew I needed them and have worn them, you know, a lot. But let's talk about that for a second. What are the, because I got a couple of questions on this. What's the best-selling apparel? What do you sell the most of?
Our long-sleeve T-shirts and short-sleeve T-shirts.
Oh, okay. Well, that's pretty much what I would guess. But now, I have to come to the store to buy them, right?
Yes. Okay. With our apparel, we do have an online storefront, however, but right now, our online storefront is basically, you know, if you wanted to go online and order your textbooks, you would need to pay with your credit card, but we would ship your textbooks out to you. And that, you know, is kind of an advantage to our distance learning program. And our distance learning program is continuously growing. As more and more students try and take classes online, we want to try and reach out to those students and kind of offer up a service to them as well. So, you know, it's not, you know, so you will be, we would be the first person in mind whenever you wanted to buy a textbook.
Right. And, you know, that's an important point because Amazon is training us, I believe, all of us, that shipping is free because they make every purchase, you know, if you purchase this amount or whatever, shipping is free, and you're offering that same thing. So I think that's an excellent way for our bookstore to compete, getting those books out to people if they use it online. Are you planning to expand the online store?
Hopefully, okay. given some time, and that's one of the things that we have to work with. It takes time a lot of times to get things to kind of work in our favor and work out all the kinks and everything. But, you know, as we go forward, we're going to continuously look at different ways to offer up different things for the students.
Right. And, you know, one of the things that I, when you and I were discussing the bookstore, you know, it occurred to me that while you might show that you're making a little bit of a profit, it really sounds like you're trying to roll those profits right back into the students.
Yeah. You know, one of the biggest things that we see now is the bookstore tends to look like the bad guy. Like, you know, they're there, they're making all this money. But, you know, a lot of times I think people tend to forget that there's a lot of overhead costs that goes into that. But one of the things that I'm in the process of doing now is looking at ways to give back to the students. Because, you know, ultimately it's kind of like with the college, if we didn't have our students, we wouldn't be there. So, right. You know, we want to show that we appreciate our students. So in the future, I'm looking at the possibility of possibly offering a scholarship for our students, you know, through the bookstore.
Oh, that's excellent. Yeah, I mean, and it occurs to me, as I mentioned, the only way that you really can compete with the large ones is some type of customer service.
Yeah.
You mentioned a program that you're, I think, considering doing is the Refer a Friend program?
Yeah, we're going to look at the possibility of doing that. Maybe, you know, in the future we can roll out this program. It's still kind of in the works. It's nothing set in stone yet, but it's just an idea that's been tossed up. We're looking at, you know, possibly if you're a student out there at James Sprunt, we're going to set up this, you know, referral process to where you can refer another student to come out there and possibly change their life.
No, that's an excellent idea. Because, you know, it's public knowledge that across the community college system, enrollment is down and stuff. And so one of the things that James Sprunt is, as every other community college is, we're trying to increase enrollment and, and working on things to do that. And that's a great segue into the next topic for discussion. Back, five, six, seven, 8 years ago, James Sprunt used to offer an open house, right?
We did.
And I understand it's coming back on May 28th.
Yeah, we're bringing it back full force. We're hoping to turn it into an annual event. And, you know, every year, probably about the March, April time frame, we're going to look at bringing the open house up there so we can get everybody in the community out there to see the programs and services that James Sprunt has to offer.
Yeah, and you sent an email to all James Sprunt employees sort of highlighting what is going to happen at the open house and then the volunteers that you're going to need. So let's talk about it. It is on the 28th, right?
Yes. Uh-huh.
And what would somebody that's interested in coming to it, what's going to, how are they going to participate in the open house?
Sure. Well, it's going to be May the 28th. We're going to have a session that starts at 4:30, and then we're going to have a session that starts at 6:30. And the tentative schedule or the tentative itinerary that we kind of have now is we will be having a meet that is going to start in our Monk Auditorium. So you'll go there for a general session, and basically you're going to hear talk about different areas on the campus, whether it be our transfer programs or, you know, a word from the financial aid office, kind of similar. I know a lot of people may have heard that we do that with our new student orientation. It's kind of give you an overall breadth of what the college has there. From there, we're going to do a campus tour. And then after we get done with the campus tour, you'll break off. So if you're interested in going into our electrical program or graphic design program or general education degree, any, you know, particular program that you're interested in, you would actually break off and go back to that part of the college, and you will be able to spend about 30 minutes with the people there and talk about the different programs, what it has to offer, get a really good in-depth. Once you get done with that, you will come over to our Strickland Commons area, and in our Commons area, we're going to have different tables set up, and that's going to be where our bookstore is, the financial aid office, admissions, our student government association, small business center, distance learning, our, I don't know if I said foundation or not, but, you know, our foundation is really key in our school. You know, going off of what you were saying earlier, a lot of our students on a certain level receive financial assistance, and, you know, our foundation is there to actually help our students as well. So if you aren't able to receive financial aid, maybe your family contribution is a little too high and you're outside of the range for what you can get for Pell Grant, you can actually sign up and get a scholarship through our foundation. So, you know, we kind of want to bring everything together right there in that one little area so you can spend time and get all the information you can.
Yeah, and, you know, to say what Jimmy is telling you, that foundation is very, very important. We are looking to raise money, and if Jimmy hasn't talked to you, he will be talking with you to raise money. But it's for a great cause, just like you mentioned.
Yes.
One of the primary objectives of the foundation is to provide scholarships for students, and even those students that might not be eligible for federal monies or
exactly,
or those types of things. So that part's really important. So how are we promoting this open house?
Right now, we're in the process now of finalizing a name. We're kind of going outside the norm here, so we don't want to just say it's specifically the JSCC Open House. So we're working on finishing up the name, but we will be marketing. There will be signage throughout, you know, all of the small businesses. We're going to use our social media resource. We're going to look at the possibility of advertising on radio, and hopefully we can go as far as advertising on TV.
Yeah. Well, you know, one of the things, Ken, the engineer here at Surge Radio, when you said advertise on radio, he gave that a thumbs up. So I think we have an enthusiastic participant there. And
well, yeah, that's great.
And I did offer to sit down and talk with Ken about getting the open house on on the radio. But, you know, one of the things, too, looking at, you know, you're going to also use social media, school's webpage and Facebook pages, and, you know, the Small Business Center will be promoting it as well. And as you mentioned, we will be there, too. And we're hoping to get a pretty broad, you know, range of folks, because if you look at James Sprunt's enrollment, it's anywhere from 14 to 82, and just about everyone in between. And so I did submit a suggestion for the open house. I said, there's a class for that. because, you know, that's one of the things that I've learned since coming to work at James Sprunt is just how broad our offering is. If you are interested in learning more about something, it's quite likely there is a class for that.
Definitely, yeah. I mean, you're looking at even the retail world, or you know, the outside. Say you're in electrical, you could come back and get recertified through our continuing education program. We got basic skills. So say you dropped out of your high school, and you here you are working at McDonald's now, and you're just thinking that, you know, I'm never gonna, you know, be able to amount to anything else. Well, you know, come back and you know, don't give up. You know, come back and talk with somebody at James Sprunt, because you can always get your general education high school diploma there. And then, you know, we would love to sit down and talk with you, and possibly once you get done with that, go ahead and enroll you in an associate degree program or diploma program or certificate program. But yeah, I really like there's a class for that, because generally, you know, if you can think of it, we chances are have a class for it.
Well, you know, and that's, it's interesting, because my wife Lydia took a sewing class, and actually I think she made an apron, and it looks pretty good actually. And I've worked in textiles for a big portion of my life, so you know, I was looking at evaluating it technically. She did a great job. And Geraldine Bryant taught that one. So, but we've had classes like cake decorating and you know, all kinds of. And the other thing I tell people is, first of all, as you're saying, there's no wrong door at James Sprunt. Reach out to whomever you know or find. And if that isn't the right area to address whatever your question is, we'll find it. We'll find who to get you to and get your questions or, you know, issues answered. You know, we have, do you know, and we'll see if I test you here, do you know how many textbooks you offer in the bookstore?
Not right off. If I had to guess, just by looking at our textbook book list, I would say at least over 100 different textbooks for the programs or classes that we offer there on campus. Because sometimes, you know, you have one textbook for one class, but then sometimes a class can require more than one textbook. So, you know, for a biology class, for instance, there might be a textbook and a lab manual that goes along with it. So you're looking at two separate books for that one class.
Yeah. You know, and as I say each week, it's hard to believe that we've gotten halfway through our show, and we're going to keep right on talking about it. But I do want to open up the phones if you're interested and want to call in. Our call-in number is 910-289-2031. Again, that call-in number is 289-2031, and you're listening to the Community and Small Biz Update for Duplin County. And I'm your host, Lee Woodard, and our guest today is Anthony Scholler, and we've been talking about the bookstore at James Sprunt and some of the elements about it, and how it is truly a small business and that competes with some very large companies, and also trying to promote the open house that we hope people will come out. Again, the number is 289-2031. Don't be shy. Call in with your questions, or call in to make a contribution to the foundation, or to buy a shirt. We can take care of that too, right?
Oh, yeah, most definitely.
Yeah. one of the things is, you know, I asked that question, Anthony, about how many books that you offer, and I did that because there is a class for that. We have such a broad range, right,
yes,
of programs that we offer. And, you know, one of the things, talk a little bit about, you mentioned it, and I meant to ask you about it, and I kept right on asking you other questions. You said you can rent a textbook.
You can.
Talk a little bit about that.
Yeah, well, if you go to our bookstore webpage, which is jamesfront.edu, up on the right-hand top of the page, we got a link that says for the bookstore. Once you go there, you can actually click on, we're actually in the process now of switching over companies. Right now, there's a link there that says rent your textbooks online, but that will probably be coming down in the next few days, and we're going to be having the new company come in. But students can save a lot of money by renting textbooks. So, you know, at one point I had it figured out, I think it was probably about 70-some percent, if not more, that they're saving. So, you know, a textbook I would sell brand new in the bookstore would cost you over $200. You can go online and rent it for 40 or 50. So, and you're looking at a 125-day term, which would carry you through a whole semester. The good advantage for that is, you know, say you're in a math class. Well, generally, you know, a lot of times people in general classes, they're not going to hold on to those textbooks. If I'm taking a math class, I'm just going to use my textbook until I'm done with the class, and then I'm not going to need it no more. So, you know, offering the rental program really is an advantage to the students because they can get rid of those unwanted textbooks and not have to put so much money into them.
Yeah, that was the example that I was thinking about. We have a lot of liberal art focuses like general education or college transfer where you're required to take math, but at the end of the day, it is not what you want to major
exactly
in. It is not what you want to do, and you're going into it kicking and screaming because you don't really have a choice. But you're absolutely right. Yeah. Renting a textbook. And, you know, I mentioned that I never sold any of my college textbooks, and I don't think that says anything other than I couldn't figure out what I wanted to do, so I kept them all. But I think renting is just what a wonderful option for our students. And, you know, you hit on something there, too, and I love the way that the bookstore is so customer-focused, but James Sprunt really is a bargain if you think about mm-hmm. cost-effectiveness. I think when we had the VOTEC program with Jeff Myers and the students on here, I think you can drill down. I think we charge $75 for a semester hour, but when you drill down to the contact hours and all the time students spend, I think, you know, it is dollars that mm-hmm. people spend in order to you know, get their degree or diploma or certification, and there's lots of benefit there, and there's a lot, you know, I'll tout the Small Business Center, there's a lot of related things that you can do while you're in your degree program.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I try to get people to the Small Business Center. If you're in a degree program, say auto mechanic or graphic design or barber or cosmetology or any of those, there's a possibility that you're going to decide
exactly
to go out and start your own business. Well, why not participate at the Small Business Center while you're there?
Yeah.
So you're armed with you know, the knowledge to how to start your own business.
And a lot of those classes that you do offer are free, so you can come up there and take them for a matter of nothing. It's just a matter of invest in the time.
Yeah, and you know, I am not allowed to collect money. That's one of the major no-nos of the Small Business Center. So for one-on-one counseling or for the workshops and seminars that we sponsor, I can't charge. I'm not allowed to. But, you know, I am able to run for-fee classes, but I have to do them through somebody else. So I would have to do them through continuing ed or those types of things. But, you know, we do offer, and, you know, I'd never thought about it, but one of the things that I might do is come to visit you and see if we can put some resources for clients in the bookstore.
Oh, yeah, most definitely.
I hadn't really thought about that. We're working on that right now in the library to have a set resource area that if they can't get up with me or they need something specific, I can just send them right over there, and we're trying to build it virtually as well as
yes.
physically putting it there. But it occurs to me that I might want to ask you to carry some things that would be related to small business.
And likewise, you know, not only is the Small Business Center there, you know, it's good for the community and good for those enrolled in a degree program or any other program that we offer there at James Sprunt, but, you know, it's also an advantage to our employees as well, because you take me, for example, with me working in the bookstore, I can always go over there to the Small Business Center and get a lot of useful resources or gain more knowledge on different areas of the bookstore, so maybe, you know, promotional strategy or, you know, different areas like that that I'm not, you know, too familiar with, I can go there and get more knowledge on it.
Yeah, and, you know, you and I plan on working with the Small Business Center. Exactly. And looking at it, treating it like a Small Business Center. And it's not that the Small Business Center is so smart, it's just a function of I'm that old. I've experienced a lot of stuff and in many ways have learned how not to do it, and that's really instructive on how to do it. So having made a lot of mistakes to get here, but I do have 35 years experience in large and small business. So and we are going to work on some of the promotion strategies for the Small Business Center. You know, one of the things that you mentioned, and the bookstore is part of that, is And I think we mentioned it when we talked with Jeff and everyone else. James Sprunt, the community college experience, is a great trial for getting ready to go to college. And you know firsthand, right?
Oh, yes, most definitely. I try and tell everybody that I talk to, the community college is your best resource. Whenever you're fresh out of high school, I would recommend everybody going to a community college. You know, the community college system, the reason why I say it's the best resource is because you're going there, you're getting acclimated to the environment. It gives you the opportunity to kind of see how things operate. And, you know, not only that, but we're so much smaller. You know, you can't beat that with a university. Outside of that, the cost effectiveness. You take our biology class or our Psych 150 class, our general psych class. You go and take one of those classes at a university, you're looking at a couple of hundred students in one class. Our classes cap out generally at about 20 to 30 students. So you have more of a one-on-one experience with your instructor. You're known by name a lot of times. You have a close connection with your instructor, and you're not going to get that in university. A lot of times you're not going to, your instructor is not going to know who you are. You're a number. So, you know, the advantages of it is just so great.
Yeah, you know, you're absolutely right. And I can, you know, I'll share a story about my daughter. I don't think she'll mind me sharing it, and one about myself as well. For me, I didn't get known by the faculty or professors until I declared a major, and I was in that department over and over and over again. So they did learn my name, but all the other classes, you know, the 2/3 of classes I took, you're absolutely right. Nobody knew me from anywhere else, and I'll tell one of the stories on me. I was a pretty good student, and I tended to play by all the rules and do the things that you're supposed to. But when it came to my next to last or last semester, when I worked with my advisor, we found that I had business or social science short that I needed. And so I looked through what was available, and economics was one of the things that was available that would meet the criteria. So I took the very first general economics class. I think it was macroeconomics. And I showed up for the first day of class and got the syllabus and got all the stuff that was there, saw what the book was. And the instructor, the professor, was very clear on how we were going to be measured. You know, we were going to write a few papers, and then we were going to take multiple choice tests three times through the semester. So I looked at all this and I said, hey, I got this. You know, I'll buy the book. I'll read the book, do fine on the test, and I know what I'll write my papers on. So I essentially stopped going to the class, and because I had other things I wanted to do and wasn't looking. And I showed up for a class about midway through the semester. I mean, I didn't completely stop going, but you know, if anything came up in that week, I would blow it off. And I went to one of the classes, and after, the professor asked Mr. Woodard if he would stop by and see him after the class. And I did, and he indicated to me that I was failing his class. And I was like, excuse me? We had had two tests then, and I had scored high A's on them. I turned in one paper and got a high A on that, and I couldn't understand what he meant by I was failing. He said, well, if you go to page one of your syllabus, you'll see that I have a no-cut policy, and you are absent too many times, and so you're going to fail. And I immediately started thinking, okay, what can I do here? And negotiated a settlement with him that if I did perfect on the exam, he would give me the grade that I earned. And I started attending every class, and I did well on the exam. Fortunately, I was able to negotiate. But you're right. Often in college, when you first start out, you're just a number, and you don't have the opportunity to get some special attention if you need it or whatever. Yeah. And I know James Sprunt certainly offers that. We have a pretty strong relationship, or if you want it, a pretty strong relationship with the faculty.
There's a lot of our students that, you know, they graduate high school in June, and first part of August, they're moved off. And then come January, they're back at James Sprunt. And we love it, you know. They go off, they get that big world experience, and they realize, you know, I think I bit off a little bit more than I can chew. So they come back to James Sprunt, and, you know, they end up loving it. You know, it's more of the smaller environment, and they're able to further acclimate to it. And then from there, they get their two-year degree, and then they transfer on out.
Yeah, and, you know, one of the growing demographics for James Sprunt is the high school students. One of the things, part of Duplin promise, that every child will have the opportunity to get a college degree, a college education. We have more and more high school students that are starting to take classes at James Sprunt.
That's a really good advantage.
Oh yeah, it is. My daughter is part of the early college, or in the early college, and you know, she's going to graduate not just with her high school degree, but she's going to graduate with 2 years her associate degree for college transfer.
Yeah.
And it didn't cost us anything, which, what a deal.
Yes.
She's gotten 2 years, and it's real easy for me to compute what the economics are on that. You just take what your average cost of tuition, books, and subsistence at a college and multiply it by two, and you can see what the value of having that. But you know, one of the strong things that, and my daughter Rachel is taking the SAT this morning, but so she's having a much worse day than I am. In fact, interestingly, last night, Lydia, her mom, said, do you have everything you need? Pencils, your calculator? No, she didn't. So we scurried around the house to find number two pencils. It was at one point I was going to email you, I think I might need to buy a calculator. But fortunately, one of our neighbors had one, and so she got what she needed to take the SAT today. But, you know, you bring up a really important point, and that is the relationship that our students can have. Rachel started taking her college classes, and she got behind in one of them. And the reason she got behind was she was using an iPod Touch to read her email and do everything. And so she was getting her assignments, but she was never completing her assignments. And, you know, she would do half of them. Well, as it turns out, she was reading one screen full of information that was required, and she was never scrolling down to read the rest of it, so she missed, you know, a fair amount of what was assigned. And under any other circumstances, she would have flunked that class.
Yeah.
However, the instructor, once everything was kind of understood, worked with her. She didn't get a great grade, but at least she didn't have to repeat taking the class. And that was a real valuable lesson for her.
You know, I can say from experience that we have a team of awesome instructors on our campus. They're knowledgeable about what they do, and they're willing to work with the students in order to help them succeed.
Yeah, I mean, I know it sounds a bit trite, but I don't think I've ever seen an institution that is as focused on the student. And you mentioned it, the student's success is what we're all trying to work about. One of the things is, you know, we're three quarters of the way through the show. You mentioned some things that you're going to try. You know, one of them is the Sprunt Innovation Award. Talk a little bit about that.
Well, it's just a thought.
Yeah, sure.
just an idea. I would let her propose up. You know, if you bring forth an innovative idea, you know, let's reward you for it, because, you know, at our institution, one of the biggest things that we want to push is forward thinking and progressing in order to make us grow as an institution. So, you know, one of the things that we have there are the resources, you know. So if we bring our staff and faculty in and, you know, say, hey, you know, if you do an innovative award, here you go, here's, you know, or if you do an innovative idea and it's used, then here you go, here's an award, because, you know, we want to let you know that you're appreciated.
Yeah.
So, it's just a thought. You know, it's nothing that's been proposed yet. So,
I think it's a great idea, though. I mean, you and I talked about it as you try to make a team environment, as you try to, as we said, no wrong door, and promote other parts of the college if that's what's appropriate for a student. One of the things that helps, I think, galvanize those kinds of efforts is being recognized for doing something innovative. I mean, we can all say that's not important, but we're lying. We all like to be recognized,
most definitely,
you know, for doing something that's helpful. In the last few minutes that we have, again, if you want to call in, we certainly have time. The telephone number is 289-2031 if you've got questions about the open house, or if you've got questions about the bookstore, or if you want to buy a shirt, you know, you're more than welcome to call in, and we'll see what we can do to take care of it. But let's go back and just sort of repeat ourselves a little bit on the open house. When is it?
It's going to be May the 28th. We're going to have two sessions. The first session will be at 4:30, and the second session will be at 6:30.
And we're going to have people come to where? How will they know where to go?
They're going to start out in our Hoffler building. So if you come up on campus, you're going to come up in the main drive. You're going to be facing the McGowan building, which is going to be on your right. And the Hoffler building is going to be the two-story building on your left. In the end of our Hoffler building, we have our Monk Auditorium. So that's where everybody is going to kind of start out. And then from there, we'll go into our campus tour, and then break off into the program clusters, and then end in our Strickland Center.
I think you and I sort of added it up. The commitment that someone would have is about 4 hours to begin this, beginning to end. You would have your 2 hours. You're shaking your head no. I don't know where I got 4 hours. 2 hours? How long do we think it'll be?
Well, each little session is going to approximately be about 30 minutes. So, if, you know, you're looking at about four. So, you know, at the most, 2 hours.
Okay, 2 hours.
Hour and a half, 2 hours, somewhere along in there.
Well, I figured they were going to stop by the Small Business Center and want to talk to me, and they'd be there for at least another 2 hours. That's why it must be how I came up with the 4 hours. anyway, about a two-hour commitment then for being there. And I'm sure we'll have lots of folks on campus to help them if they get lost or redirect them.
Yes. Yeah, because it can kind of be overwhelming once you first go on campus, but, you know, we don't want anybody lost.
Right.
We want to be able to show you around and also show you everything that we do have to offer.
Yeah, and, you know, I strongly encourage people to take advantage of this open house because, as we mentioned, there is absolutely no, you know, there's so much offered at James Brunt. People don't really realize how broad the offerings are. And, you know, I would even tell people if they have an idea of a class that they want to take and James Brunt doesn't offer it, you should come to this open house and suggest that you.
Exactly. Yeah. Most definitely. And you know, we want to open it up to everybody. So, you know, it could be this person that's in high school now and maybe doesn't know exactly what they want to do or where they want to go. So, you know, come up here to the open house, kind of get an idea of what we have to offer, and you may end up wanting to come to James Brunt. You know, it's local. You can save money by coming there. You can still live at home, so you're looking at your room and board expense cut right there. The other side of the house, you may have someone that's working somewhere now and they may want a career change, so we invite those to come out. So you may have somebody that is enrolled in another institution and they want to come back closer to home. So, I mean, like I said, you know, we're not limiting the open house. We want anybody and everybody to come out. We definitely want to let everybody know. You know, I think sometimes, like you have said, James, people tend to forget about James Brunt. We're almost kind of like the hidden treasure of Duplin County. You know, we do have a lot to offer, so we want to let everybody know what we have to offer and get everybody out there.
Yeah, And if someone listening is interested in getting more information about the open house, how might they do that?
Most definitely. In the next few days, we're going to be working on trying to post some information on our online website. So if you have online availability, you can go to www.jamessprunt.edu. There will be some advertisements there. Also, if you don't have online access, you can call 910-296-2400. And or, you know, call me in the bookstore. My number is 910-296-2510, and I will do what I can to direct you where you need to go. If you know you want to come to open house, but you're, you know, really interested in going ahead and trying to get into our fall semester, I can hook you up with admissions, or you can also call our admissions department directly. Their number is 910-296-2500, and they can tell you the steps you will need to take in order to get your application filled out, and they can also direct you over to our financial aid department, or you can also call our financial aid department. Their number is 910-296-2503.
Wow, you know all the numbers far better than I do, but I can tell you, if you want to, you can call the Small Business Center at 296-2431. That's my number, or 2430. That's Tammy's number. But, I mean, it's really important. You know, there is an abundance of ways that you can reach out and tie into to James Brunt. But part of it is just coming up or understanding what it is that we can and will offer. One of the things that you mentioned is this open house. We really are trying to reach out to the whole community. Yes. Yeah, and make sure that everyone knows what we're offering. The other thing, too, you mentioned, let's talk a little bit more about it. We're promoting the open house through a variety of sources. You mentioned we'll have it on the webpage. You mentioned that you can call the 296-2400, which is just the general number for James Sprunt.
Yes.
But I think we're also promoting it through the foundation, and we're going to be promoting it to local businesses and yes. everything else. You're on the committee, right,
for
the open house. I'm not.
Well, we're going to want you to come out to our next meeting. We're going to be having another session that we'll be holding this coming up Tuesday, and we're definitely going to want you to come out.
Uh-oh. Yeah, and one of the things I did offer is I have some tools maybe at the Small Business Center that I can reach some people that wouldn't ordinarily be reached, and I really do think we ought to promote it. And that's something I do in the workshops, is I tell people that there are other classes at James Sprunt that could support this, because the example I use in the Small Business Center this past semester, if you will, I offered QuickBooks, which is accounting software, if folks don't know. And I offered Adrian Jarrell, the accounting instructor at James Sprunt, is the one who taught the class. And we actually put together three classes, What Gets Measured, Gets Managed, which was really Financial Accounting 101. And then we talked about how to use QuickBooks, and then we talked about some advanced elements of QuickBooks, like if you have employees and how you would set that up. But one of the things I didn't think about, which was ended up being a big issue, is we had people in there who weren't really capable of using a computer, we had people in there who used QuickBooks every day. And obviously that gave Adrian a challenge to try to teach and give something of benefit to everyone. And that's when it clicked on me that I didn't really offer this in the wisest way, perhaps. Should have offered it an overview, QuickBooks for Dummies, if you will, not to insult anyone, but that approach. And then I should have offered in continuing ed, I've gotten continuing ed to offer a for fee QuickBook that can actually get into it in more detail. Because I have some flexibility with workshops, but most of them tend to be 3 hours. There's a limit to how much you can actually do in 3 hours, and I would think a 20-hour course in QuickBooks would be more appropriate. And I say that because many of the people who came to the QuickBooks seminar were expecting to pay. I had people register and then say, how much is it? And I said, it's free. And they were blown away with the fact that it was free. And, you know, but that's what occurred to me is maybe we ought to make a continuing ed. And, you know, it occurred to me, too, when we look at the bookstore, especially as it pertains to business, if we look at what are the resources that people need in the bookstore, maybe there's some things the Small Business Center can do to support them. I hadn't really thought about that until we were sitting here. Well, we're just about out of time, Anthony. Is there anything that anything else that you'd like to add about either the bookstore or the open house?
No, you know, outside of everything, I definitely want to make sure that everyone knows that they are invited to come out to our open house, which is going to be May the 28th. We're going to have that first session at 4:30 and the second session at 6:30. Definitely come out. Let's show you what James Sprunt has to offer you. And you know, our little tagline for James Sprunt, your bricks to success. And I can honestly say from personal experience that James Sprunt has been my bridge to success. And you know, we want to gather everybody out and let's help everybody cross that bridge.
Yeah, and you know, one of the things that I think is vital, as you said, is it reaches not just the typical high school graduate or whatever.
Yeah, it's everyone.
It's everyone. Mm-hmm. To come out. And one of the things that we talked about is there are other options too. There's the leadership programs.
Exactly.
James Sprunt offers so many things. And the cost of them is really low.
Yeah.
I don't think there's a bargain anywhere else. Well, Anthony, it has been a wonderful time working with you and talking with you. I look forward to participating in the open house. Again, you were listening to the Community and Small Business Update. Next Saturday, we will be talking about financial aid and student support services for James Sprunt. Brian will be here, and we're looking forward to doing that. Hope everyone has a wonderful weekend, and we'll talk to you in a week. Goodbye.